All right, so I guess we can start. We have just a few more weeks to go before the end of the course. And now, there's a few important things that I need to draw your attention to at this moment. Now, first thing first, have you already know your midterm score? No? Really? I guess you know your score already. Okay, so if you want to see how good your midterm score is, then I would like to invite you to go to, click on the name on the top right, and then click on, click on your name. Then on the left side, you should see the activity reports, okay? On the left side. Should be able to see it. Click on the name, and on the left side, click on activity report, and then click on complete report. Okay, for example, for this student, when I click on the complete report, I can see views for the, resource pages in our topic, forum posts. Yeah, quite nice. She has a lot of posts in the Introducing Yourselves forums. She was present in these classes. Okay. So fair views for the later resources, and this is her literature review. Okay. And okay, quite a lot of good concepts in there. But I'm starting from the topic for research design. I do not see any activities for the resources in topic 4. Okay, see here, videos, quizzes, mean, mode, median. Okay, there has been no attempt here. And look like starting from topic 5. Okay, see, gets neglected. And I do not see a lot of activities for evaluations. Similarly, for topics 7, 8, and 9, a lot of never seen here. Okay? So, can you see your activity report? strange because in the other courses you should be able to sit. Okay. I will try to make the activity report available to everyone. Okay, let's try this way. Go to the course homepage and then find the participant list. Okay, this here. Yeah, you see the link to participants here? You see this block? Okay, click on participants and then find your name. Well, I am able to see yours, but not sure if you can see yours too. So click on the name in the participants list. And then on your side, you see, do you see the activity report? Okay, in the control panel. Oh yes, you can see it now. All right, how do you do that? Go to participants. Now, how you do it? Oh yes, it's available now. Yeah. So, now it's available. Everybody can see the complete activity report, okay? And you know how good your work profile is from the system. This is what I use to evaluate your midterm, okay? So, if you see labels, if you see forums that are empty, if you see links that you have never seen, if you see quizzes that you have never done, you still have about 2 more weeks to complete all these activities. Okay, so during the long holiday ahead, okay, this is something you should pay attention to for the course. All right, so any question? Everybody can see your profile now, okay? And you know how good it is. So that's job number one. Now, the next big task is video presentations activity. You can see that the instruction is at the end of the topic, and it is also due the week after next. So I want everybody to reflect on what you have learned so far before we wrap everything up by creating a video presentation. That's simple. You can use a laptop, use a webcam on a laptop, their smartphone, okay, record a video, and try to make it a good video, because this is an essential skill too. So from the previous courses, these are the things that you can learn. Number one, make sure that there is no strong light, okay, at your back. For example, I try to close that window so that we can have good recording on the webcam. Okay, so light will reflect from my face to the camera. And you should do the same too, because some students will just shoot their video with their head in front of very strong light, and that makes their face really dark. And when you speak, make sure that you dress formally. I do not want to see your video with casual dressing. Okay, dress formally, and make sure that you you mind the background. Some people have lots of things in the background, the videos that should not show in the public. You know what I mean? So just that. So shoot the video. Okay. This is a very common project in a lot of subjects now. And then upload the video to YouTube, okay? And then link the YouTube video back to the forum. Now, let me show you how to do it. So, I click on the forum. So it's like this, right? And click on add a new discussion. Sorry, I think I should change the setting in the forum to be single discussion so that everybody can make only a post by reply, not general forum. Okay, so you can only reply, and right, so I click on reply here. Now, instead of typing my message here, I will click on video, insert multimedia, okay, click on that, and then click on find and upload a video, and now I click on YouTube, okay, then I search for my video name. You should name the video so that you can search it. For example, my nickname is Tisonet, and I want to search for the recording screen recording of our previous meeting. For example, I click on here, and I think I should do it again. Tisonet. Recording, screen recording. Oh, I do not name it screen recording, sorry. It should be applied linguistic research. So I just, so videos about research with my, oh, and you see there are lots of them out there. Then I can click on this, for example. Like this, click on insert and post to forum. Now, this is what it should look like in our forum. Okay, so instead of reading your writing, I want to see you in action. So when I do the midterm evaluation, I have your forum post, I have your profile, I have your face, I have your voice, I have all the things that are essential to help me make decisions. Okay, so is that easy for you? And make sure that's about 3 minutes only. To summarize what you have learned according to the guideline, make a video post and attach it to our form. Now, any other questions or comments before we move on further? So there are two more things that you need to pay attention to: your activity report and the video presentations. Now, today we are going to keep going with t-tests, and before I start showing you how we do t-tests, I want to review a little bit what we have already done with SPSS. Now, I need you to go back to the SPSS data for practice folder in our system, download the survey third edition file. I hope you still remember what to do. And then answer the two last research questions on the slide. Okay, last time we worked on the first questions about analyzing correlation between total perceived stress and total life satisfaction. I need you to check the strength of correlation between total self-esteem and total life satisfaction. And then another check for total social desirability and total life satisfaction. How many people in our class have already installed SPSS on their computer, your own computer? Nobody? Really? Now, later on, if you want to look for a job, this is probably one of the skills that you need to show to the employer. When you apply for a job, proudly say, I can use SPSS to write research, to analyze research data, and you will get a plus for the application. Now, do it. Second question, total self-esteem and total life satisfactions. See if they have any relationship, any correlation. Now, it has any correlation between total self-esteem and life satisfactions? Yes or no? Okay. What is the R value? Total life self-esteem and life satisfactions. Yeah, 0.488. And this is considered as fair correlation. I'm going to show you how to read that with code MD. And for the third questions, how about social desirability and life satisfaction? Yes or no? It's only 0.1. There is a correlation, but it's quite weak. In his research book, sorry, in his book about educational research, Cohen suggests these guidelines for interpreting Pearson correlations, but this is only true with large data sets. I mean, you need to have several hundreds records. Now, do not take this at the absolute guide. I mean, when you read other books, there can be other guidelines, other instructions. And whether the relationship is strong or not also depends on how big your data is. If you have only about 10 students in a data set, probably you should not use this guideline. And that's why I do not want to show you in the beginning. Okay? We use this to work with regular data sets with several hundred records. If you use only very small sample size, then the guideline for interpreting the relationship should be different. But as a rule of thumb, we can use this to read our relationship correlation. So coming back to the two findings that you have found with social desirability and life satisfactions, the relationship is very small, okay? A very weak relationship. And with the second questions on life satisfaction and self-esteem, the correlation is medium, okay? Medium. Okay, I think that's enough. It's time for us to move on to another analysis. In the next part, we're gonna look at chi-square t-test and ANOVA analysis. Chi-square t-tests are most popular. Let's turn our attention away from the screen for a little while. Now, with chi-square, we have several times. The third kind of chi-square that we're going to look at is chi-square test for goodness of fit. Sounds a little bit confusing, but let's look at some example. Okay, so we call it test goodness of fit. Now, we use this to determine if the observed frequencies are different from what should be good, what we expect. Now, before we do the chi-square analysis, we need to make sure that the criteria are met. Number one, none of the expected values may be less than one. And number two, no more than 20% of the expected values may be less than five. Okay, this is called assumption checking before we do the analysis. Well, this is the formula, and we will use this to practice very soon. FE represent expected frequency, and FO represents observed frequencies. Now, look at this example, and this is a situation where we use chi-square test of goodness of fit. In the universities, there are 5 foreign languages are taught, and there are 5 foreign language classes. Now, there are usually 100 students taking the second language classes every year. Okay. And because there are 5 classes, as an administrator, I expect about 20 students for each class. If there are very few students in a language class, I may need to make a decision about whether I should maintain that class or not. Okay? So my expectation should be 20 students in a class. Okay, that's the best. Okay, my expectation. But this is my observations. This is my reality. Okay, the real number of registrations for a class. So it's 23, 20, 15, 13, 20. Okay. Now, and this is a research question for me in these situations. Of course, there are differences between what I observe and what I expect. Okay? Is the difference observed in the data collected significant? Is it really different? Okay? Is it so important that I need to make a decision? Okay, to put it another way, is the difference significant or not? Because later on, when you do experimental teaching, you would have to do the same. You would have to observe the differences between control group and experimental group. Okay? So our question here is whether the difference is meaningful, significant. Now, so to begin with, we decide the F. I hope that it rings a bell to you now. Okay, in Pearson correlation, we also need to use the F, degree of freedom. How do we get degree of freedom in Pearson correlation? N minus 2. Okay, in chi-square, it's row minus 1 multiplied by column minus 1. Number of row, number of column. Okay, and we will go back to this critical values of chi-square distribution later. Now, this is how we calculate the chi-square in the example that I have just shown. Now, this is our observed frequency, okay? First, we list all the expected frequencies in the column, and then we start to put in the formula. Now, the difference between expected and observed frequencies, okay? And then it should be divided. There is another part. Okay, the difference is squared and then divided by expected frequency. So that's just the formula. And then we need to sum all of this up. Okay, so I have another column here, and I sum all of these up. It gives me chi-square value. Okay, it's 8.2. Now, look at this again. How many columns? I'm sorry. How many columns do we have here? Two only. Observe, expect it. Okay? How many rows do we have here? Now, how many rows? Five. So, the degree of freedom is four. Okay? Now, we go to row four, and we're gonna use the 0.05. Right? What does it mean? When we use this 5% level of significance, there is only 5% of the chance that our conclusion is wrong. Okay, you got that? So, we need to make sure that our chi-square value is bigger than this. If it's bigger than this, we say the difference is significance, okay? If it's smaller than this, we say the difference is not statistically significant, okay? Right, so I compare, and I see that this is smaller than 9.49, and I come to the conclusion that there is no significant difference between the observed and the expected values in this situation. So, I do not need to worry much about the difference in class size of the different language classes. Okay, is it acceptable statistically? Okay? Or is it normal statistically? Any questions or comments? So let's have another example. I go into the casino, okay? And then I play a game. By throwing the dice, okay? Now, if the game is fair, and I throw, in total 120 times, okay? I throw the dice 120 times, okay? Now, my expectation is that, because there are six sides of the dice, each side should appear equally in turns. Okay, that's my ideal expectation. Okay, so if I throw it 120 times, I expect about 20 times for 1, 20 times for 2, 20 times for 3, 20 times for 4, 5, 6. Okay, so my expectation is this. But this
see cái what actually happens in the casino in the game. Okay? I want you to use your knowledge about statistics to decide whether this game is fair or not, whether this is unusual to have only five times for six, and a lot more for three and five. Okay? You need to prove this using statistics. Okay. So now let's do it. The real freedom indicator is 5. Okay? 6 rows, 2 columns. Now, take down the data, and I will show you the form for you to practice. So do you now understand why you get the name goodness or fit test? Okay? Now, before we do this, we need to track assumptions. There are two assumptions that need to be made. Number one, no value is less than 1. Okay, all of them are bigger than 1. Okay. Number two, no more than 20% of the members in the data are less than 5. Okay. We have only 1 5 here. So, all those two assumptions are met, or all those two criteria are met. We can carry on doing chi-square calculation without, worrying about making mistake, without worrying about validity. That's what I mean. Okay, so you have taken down all the data. Now practice this. Okay, so what is the chi-square value that you get for that problem? What's your chi-square? 27.5. Do you get the same value? So, is it a fair game or not? No. Okay, it's not a fair game because the difference between our observations and our expectations is statistically significant. Okay, statistically significant. So, the dice turning in this case is not fair. Okay, it's time for us to do SPSS. Now go back to your survey third editions again. Turn to variable view. Now, look at this data set. There is a variable called smoker. Okay? And the researcher would go around the company asking on the employee this question, do you smoke? Okay? So yes, it's coded as 1. No, it's coded as 2. Okay, and using this data, the researcher knows how many people in this company smoke. Now, in a previous national survey, 20% of the population smoke. Okay, so that's our expectation. We expect the rate of smoking in this company to be the same as that from the national survey. But we are not sure whether there is any difference. Okay? So we have the expectation, right? Should be 20% of smoker. And this is our observations, okay, from the data. Okay? So the question that we want to answer in this case is this. Is the number of smokers in the data file the same to that reported in literature from previous national or nationwide study? Okay? Now, our hypothesis in this case is that 20% are smoker and 80% are non-smoker. That's in our expected value, expectations. So this is what we do. We go to analyze parametric test and go to chi-square.
So we put in
$20 and $80. That's the our expectations, and it counts the number. Okay, our expectation is that 20%. Now the total number of employees is 436. Okay, we expect 20%. This number to be smoker, 80% to be non-smoker. So this is our expectation. Okay, and this is our observations. This is the actual data collected in the company. Number of smoker and the non-smoker. Actually, you see, okay, for your own eyes that the difference is not much, right? And then, okay, now look at this. Tell me, what is the degree of freedom in this case? What is the DF value here? You see, one. Okay, two rows and two columns. Okay, it's one. And so you see, okay, you see the degree of freedom. Now, the chi-square value is 0.69. And when we use SPSS, we always read the significance value. Okay? Because we do not use the critical table to compare. Now, this significant value is 0.7. You see, bigger than 0.05. Okay? If you come to the conclusion that there is a difference, then the significance should be smaller than 0.05. You can see this with your own eyes, actually. So we come to the conclusion that there is no difference in the smoking rate observed in this company compared to the smoking rate reported in the national study. Does it make sense? Okay. So this is how we use test of goodness chi-square. Okay. All right. Let's do another problem before we move on and take a break. How many boys are there in this class? Now raise your hands. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay. Yeah. So there are 8 boys, and in my attendance track, I see 40 people. So 8 boys and 32 girls. Now put it down for me. Usually there should be about, well, the ratio that we expect in our department is about 20%. Okay, 20% of the students are boys and 80% are girls. And in this class, we have 8 boys and 32 girls. Now, okay, tell me whether, okay, the ratios of the gender balance in this class is, okay, you know, usual or not, comparing with the previous courses that we observe and we expect in our department. Okay, so you know what to do? Okay, that's the problem. Now solve it. See how the gender balance in our class fit to, okay, the usual balance. Okay, now do it, do it. Now this guy don't use SPSS, it doesn't help. is your answer? Is it normal or not? Huh? It's normal. Okay, it's normal. What is your chi-square value? 0. No, no. What is your chi-square value? It is 0.0. Really? Oh, so it is exactly the same? Okay, so, so the observation is perfect. Okay, just exactly 20%. I did not give you a very good problem then. Do you need to take a break? Shall we just go on and start at 10:30? Okay, come on, you need to decide. I don't want to make decisions all the time. Okay, so 10 minutes break. Okay, because some of you need to recharge, I know. Okay. Fools, go on the bed. 10 minutes break and then we move on. So let's get back. The next chi-square that we're going to look at, and this is the chi-square that you see most often in our final exam, is a group-independent chi-square. Group-independent chi-square. Well, basically it means there are two groups. And we use it for two classes. So chi-square test of independence help us to see whether there is association between two nominal variables. Nominal variable, for example, male, female, okay, pass, fail, okay, in exam. Okay. Now the assumption that we need to check before doing this chi-square test is the same. None of the expected value may be less than 1, and no more than 20% of the expected value may be less than 5. Okay. Now our hypothesis is that the null hypothesis is that there is no association between two variables. So we just assume that there is no association between variables. This is the formula, exactly the same. Right, so this is the situation where we use chi-square test of group independence. I used a new method for teaching writing. And I want to see how effective this new method is. So I take two classes to do an experiment. Okay, in the experimental class, I use the new method. In the control class, I teach with the regular method. Okay, at the end, okay, of the course, all students from the two classes need to take final exams. Let's say it's a TOEIC exam. In the experimental class, this many students pass and this many students fail. In the control class, this many students pass, this many students fail. Okay? I want to see whether there is any difference between the experimental class and the control class. We can see with our own eyes that there is difference, but it needs to be proven scientifically. Okay? And this is the situation that requires to use chi-square test of group independence. Is it clear? Okay. This is another situation. I use Facebook in teaching English in the experimental class. In the control class, they do not use Facebook. At the end of the course, I want to see whether using Facebook trains students' preferences or trains students' perception about their interest in writing or not. Okay, my assumption, my known hypothesis is that there is no difference. And my job is to, as a researcher, I will try to reject the known hypothesis, trying to prove the opposite, okay? Right, so I will need to, so this is the data collected from experimental class. This many students like it, this many students do not, like it, do not like the writing class. In the control class, this many students like it, and this many students, 41 students, do not like it, right? So we need to prove it. Now, to begin with, degree of freedom is the same with test of goodness of fit, okay? Row minus one multiplied by column minus one. Okay, a table, critical value table, it would be the same. Now, we have on the screen here 73, 12, 43, 39. These are the observed value. Okay? What actually happens in the final test. This is our observation. Okay? Now, with this kind of chi-square, we need to calculate our expected value using this formula. And it will take time. So, you see like this. Let me use the pointer. Expected value for this cells, 1, 1. So let's say this is row 1, column 1. Okay, expected 1, 1. Okay, it would be total values of row 1 multiplied with total values of column 1. So 1, 1, total 1, total 1. Okay, got that? This multiplied with it divided by N now. Okay? This is N. Total number of the rows and the column. This is always the same. Okay? Which way you read it? So I get this, and this is our expected value for cell 1, 1. Now for cell 1, 2. Okay? It will be this multiply with this, divided by this. Right? Okay? Now, let me say this again. Expected value for this cell will be this. That's why it is a chi-square. Right. Now, expected value for this cell will be this. Okay, Z. Okay, shape. Expected for this cell will be this. Okay, so they are all here. Got it? And then you need to put them into columns and start using the formula like the chi-square test of goodness of fit. Right, now we create tables for observed expected values, the square difference, and divided by observed frequency, sum all of them up, and then compare with the tables of significance. Okay. Is it easy? Let's try. Okay, so this is done for you. Now, I want you to solve this problem for me. Now, practice this, everybody. Okay, so please answer that question. So, what is your answer? Does it change student interest in writing classes? Huh? Yes or no? Yes. What is the chi square value that you get? 1.97 or something. Okay, so the degree of freedom here will be 1, right? And we compare it with the what the chi square value? 1.9. So it's somewhere here, right? So you have about 13 or 14%. Yeah, 12 or 13%, right? 1.9. So it should be here. Huh? So about 12% of your conclusion being wrong. So is there any significant difference, okay, in the preference of the two class? No. Okay. So in this case, you need to read this 5% level. So if your chi-square is bigger than this, okay, we say that there is a significant difference between the two classes. And then you can say, okay, using Facebook, train the students' interest. Right? So, the conclusion is that using Facebook, in this case, does not train student interest. Question? Square is row minus 1 multiplied by column minus 1, and this guy, it has 2 rows. Okay, so let's clarify that. You do not use this table. What you use is this table. Okay, sorry for not making that clear in the beginning. All right, you should use this table. So 2 rows, 2 columns. By row and column, we mean this, not the kinds of row and column that you use to calculate. So the degree of freedom here should be 1, not 3. Okay, is it okay now? Now, just in time. Okay. Now, the chi-square test does not tell us about the strength of relationship. It does not show us how big the impact of the experiment is. It just tells us that, well, there is difference. That's it. It does not tell us the strength in Pearson correlation. And it is sensitive to sample size, as you see. If the sample size is too small, then even if you can infer a difference, it doesn't make sense. So when you do educational research, we always recommend okay, minimum students in a class should be around 20. Okay? It's good to have 40 or 50. Okay? But if you have less than 20 students in a class, may you know impact the validity of your chi-square statistics. Okay, chi-square test is also sensitive to small expected frequency in one or more of the cells in the table. And that's why there's an assumption that you need to check at the beginning. Okay, no more than 20% of the values should be less than 5. Okay, let's go to our survey, third edition again. And this time, okay, we go to these questions. Are males more likely to smoke than females? Okay, so we know that there are about 20%. Okay, actually, the number of smokers in this company is okay, regular, okay, comparing with that of the national study. But now, then, we also need to check okay, whether there are more okay, male smoker or female smoker. Now, our assumption, the null hypothesis here is that men and women smoke equally. Okay? So we need to okay, prove this assumption. Males are more likely to smoke in female, at least in our culture. Okay, this is the case. But let's see whether it is true in American culture. Okay, this data set is taken from American context. So we're gonna use these two variables, sex as the rows and smoker as the column, right? And okay, we use descriptive statistic cross tab. So analyze descriptive statistics cross tabs. Right? Here. Analyze descriptive statistics cross tabs. Now, the rows will be males, females. The column. Yes or no, it's smoking. So, smoker. Okay. And you see, they are all nominal. Okay, data. Okay. Male and female. Smoking and non-smoking. And then the click on statistics. Select chi-square. It's enough to select chi-square, but you can also select V and grammar's V okay, if you want to interpret okay, V and grammar's V. Okay? And continue and OK. And we get this summary here. Males, 33 smoke, 151 are non-smoker. Female, 52 are smoker, and 200 are non-smoker. So it looks like the same, right? Can see that from our own eyes. Now, when we read Pearson chi-square, see, this, in this case, the real freedom is one, not three. Okay, you got two columns, two rows. So, and our significant is 0.482. But wait. We need to read this line. Continuity corrections. We need to read the correction line. Okay. So, SPSS can calculate correction for us based on the sample size. So, expect to read this line. And I have told you many times, in order to conclude there is significant difference, this significance value needs to be smaller than 0.05. In this case, it's bigger than 0.05. Right? So we come to the conclusion that there is no statistically meaningful difference. And there is no difference. And there is no statistical difference. Okay, depending on your phrasing. Between male and females, in the smoking ratio. So men and women smoke equally in this company. Yeah. Okay. Remember to read the second line. Now, if you need to decide the effect size, I mean whether the difference is big or not. Now this is advanced statistics, and you can ignore this part if you do not want to get your attention to, because for your level, we all need you to come to the conclusion that there is difference. But now, if you want to decide whether the difference is big or small, then we use the grammar B. Okay. So in our case, it's two categories, row minus one, column minus one, equal to one. The Kramer V that is returned in SPSS is 0.034, very small, right? Actually, we have come to the conclusion that there is no difference. If there is difference, then you can read the value to see whether it is small, medium, or large. Okay. So this is the guideline for reading how big the difference is once you come to the conclusion that there are difference. Right, and this is your report. Chi-square test for independence with just continuity corrections. Of SPSS indicated no significant association between gender and smoking status, and then you report the statistic chi-square degree of freedom E1 sample size 436 is 0.34, p is 0.56. That's enough. You can report phi for the effect size, but you can ignore it. Is that easy for you? Okay. We do not have much time left. But next time, we will practice writing report. Okay. Now, just do this. Okay. Two more things. I need you to open the slip. Third editions, fine. Okay, this is a survey for people who have sleep problems. And I need you to answer the questions. Whether there is association between sex and sleep problem. I mean, do men new women have, you know, more problems in their sleep. Okay? Second question. Problem with sleep. So what is your answer? Yes or no? Problem with sleep. It should be at the top. Problem with sleep. So, what are your conclusions? Is there association between sex and sleep problems? Yes or no? No. Okay. Men and women, okay, equally have, okay, sleeping problems. Okay, according to this data set. Now, open windward. And do this, write a report for me. Now, step windward, write a report for the research that you have just done. So you see, the hard part of a research is, okay, not okay, doing statistics, computer do that for you, it's collecting data, and then, you know, write the journal. Now, so write a report. This is what you do in the final exam. Open Windward, write a report, and then ready to get it, paste it into WB1 for me to test. Okay, use this sample for your report. There is no need to report fee value. Okay. Ready? Victoria? When you're ready, paste it in. Now, can you answer to WB1 for me? Now, okay, what about this case? So you can draw like that. And then add your own interpretation, then write, okay, add one more thing. So, therefore, okay, men and women, okay, equally have sleep problems. Therefore, okay, both men and women have sleep problems equally, things like that, okay, to make it more, you know,